All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us here this evening. I'm Santa Clara County Supervisor Joe Simidian, and it is my pleasure to be the moderator for tonight's school board debate here in the Palo Alto Unified School District. I want to begin by thanking our sponsors, both the Palo Alto Weekly as well as the JCC, who have provided us with this wonderful venue. In response to questions tonight, I'm going to ask the panelists, the candidates, to understand that when we have questions from the Palo Alto Weekly and when we have questions from members of the audience, the questions will sometimes come with a certain point of view. You should feel free to take exception to the point of view if you think that that's called for. By the same token, I do want to ask that you actually answer the question. And I've been encouraged by the sponsors to prod you just a little bit with a follow-up if somehow during the course of your 60 seconds or more, you didn't quite get a chance to answer the question. So with a little gentle encouragement, I hope that we can get all the questions answered tonight. Again, feel free to take exception to the premise if you think that's appropriate, but do try to answer the questions. I know many of the audience members have already asked, how do they get a question into the hopper? And the answer is, you should be able to get a card as you walk in. And if you didn't get a card and would like one, just raise your hand. Sam here will get you a card sometime in the next minute or two. And then he'd like you to simply pass your cards all the way down to the end of the row, to my right, your left, so that he can collect them just going up and down the stairs. So Sam, if you see any raised hands, including here in the fifth row, then we'll see if we can't get a card to anyone who would like to ask questions. And let me just begin by asking the candidates to each introduce themselves just by name. I know we have the name plates right there at your feet, but I think one of the things we hope to accomplish tonight is that everybody will at least know which candidate is which. So let's start there. And at my immediate left, Ken Dauber.
Good evening, I'm Ken Dauber.
Good evening, I'm Terry Godfrey.
Hi, my name is Jay Blas-Jacob Cabrera.
Hello, I'm Catherine Crystal Foster.
Hello everyone, I'm Gina Dalma.
All right, and you're getting a little feedback, but that's par for the course in Palo Alto, so we'll work to calibrate appropriately. And let me just, before we start with the first round of questions, let me just let everyone, including the candidates, know what the process will be. We will begin with a series of questions, and we have seven that were prepared by the Palo Alto Weekly and its staff. I think we're going to try and do each of those seven questions with just 1 minute responses, and then there's an opportunity for follow-up, as I say, if perhaps the question wasn't fully answered in that 1 minute. But we're going to try and keep it to a minute for each question. The order in which the questions are answered will be by random on each question, and I will simply pull out of the basket the name of the candidate. I'll know when they know, and we'll mix it up each time. And you may get lucky, you may not, but it will be random each time, and that's to keep it lively and to keep all of us on our feet, particularly the candidates. After we've had a chance to do questions from the Palo Alto Weekly and its staff, we have, I think, a very interesting opportunity to find out what the candidates would like to know of their fellow competitors. So we have one question from each of the candidates, and we will, again, in random order, call out that question, ask the other four candidates to answer the question, and then we will let the person who actually asked the question give their own good answer. They will have had the benefit, of course, of knowing what the question was and having had some time to think about it. We'll have 90 seconds for that particular part of the program. Once we've gone through those questions, it'll be time for audience questions. We have some that have already been submitted online. We'll have some that come up by cards. We will not have enough time for all the audience questions, so I'll be shuffling through them looking for questions that are particularly different, perhaps, than the questions we've already had from the candidates themselves and from the weekly. And then finally, there will be an opportunity for closing comments, again, entirely random, 2 minute closing comments by each candidate, the order to be determined by a draw. Not to worry if you couldn't keep track of all that as we go from section to section. I will repeat the process. And again, I want to encourage all the candidates to enjoy themselves this evening, to answer the questions fully, and I want us to begin with a great big round of applause for all five people who chose to run for the Palo Alto School. All right then. The Palo Alto Unified School District has been through a period of some controversy over the past couple of years. In some cases, that's led to a certain measure of anger, resentment, divisiveness, and certainly a number of different opinions about the conduct of the school board, the administration, school attorneys, the federal government, parents, and the media. Please assess the board's performance during this period and explain what specific actions you personally took or advocated as a member of the larger school community over the past couple of years as these controversies unfolded. If elected, what specific actions will you support or advocate that might lead to a healing of the wounds from the past 2 years? Lots to cover there. Why don't we call it 90 seconds, and our timekeeper, Bill Johnson, the fastest man in the West with a clock, will hold up a card. Jocelyn Dodd, excuse me, we've changed players. We'll hold up a yellow card when you have 30 seconds left, and we'll have a red card when your time is done. And again, on this one, even though I said 60 seconds would be the norm, I think to cover all that ground, 90 seconds. Again, we're going to have you solve world peace in 60 seconds later in the program. Again, the question is, assess the board's performance during this controversial period, explain what actions you personally took or advocated during that time, and perhaps discuss what specific actions you could support or advocate that might lead to a healing of the wounds. So, Jay Cabrera, you begin.
Excellent. Well, I will start by just saying that, you know, my direct involvement in the board has probably been, you know, less than some of the other candidates. And in the context of some of the controversies that I have, you know, researched and read about and understood to the best of my knowledge, there seems to be a lot of, like, you know, intermingling between, you know, a group of people who seem to have, you know, slight quarrels or, you know, conducts between each other over long periods of time. So the key thing for that is that being new to the school board and being new towards getting involved in the politics of the school board isn't necessarily a bad thing, because I'm bringing a brand new perspective, brand new ideas. I'm able to look at all of the issues that have been controversial with a new light, without being prejudged and having my own, you know, preconceived opinion. So the way that that transfers into bringing that to the community is that one of my top priorities, if not my actual top priority, is interactivity and really building an online, interactive, 21st century, you know, communication system with the community to have direct, real-time interactivity with the decision-making of the board, so that anybody can give input, anybody can, you know, vote on proposals, anybody can actually directly get involved in decision-making, both participatory and through online online voting. So that's my goal, is to really build a community presence and get more people involved.
Thank you, Jay Cabrera. Our next answer comes from Gina Dalla.
Thank you. And before we start, I just want to thank the JCC and the Palo Alto Weekly. So I would give the board, you asked a very specific question, and I would give it a very mixed result. I think it would be around a B-, to be very specific. There's very clear achievements that the board has had, including the strategic plan. There's some things in the strategic plan that I don't fully agree with, but just the fact that we have a strategic plan is something incredibly important. There's been two main decisions that the board has made in the past couple of years that I have disagreed about publicly. The first one was the resolution that they unanimously agreed last June in terms of the complaints that have been filed, the civil rights complaint that have been filed against the school district by the Office of Civil Rights. In this decision, I disagreed mainly because I thought it was a key decision that prevented the school district to keep on learning in terms of becoming an environment, to truly provide an excellent education for all our students. I think that the fact that we were fighting the OCR instead of collaborating with the OCR instead of improvement was something that I didn't agree on. The other thing was the unifying proposal that was submitted by Palo Alto school teachers, and we will discuss that in a follow-up question.
Comments about what might be done and what actions you might take in the coming years to lead to a healing of the wounds?
Thank you. So first of all, I would truly build a collaborative spirit in our community. I think we have a new superintendent. That's a huge opportunity. He has a clear vision for success, and we need to make sure that we're all, as a community, working together to achieve a vision of excellence for all our students.
Thank you very much. Our next candidate is Terry Godfrey.
So in the last few years, the role I played in the district, has been as board president of PI. And in that role, you represent the PI board, which is our educational foundation, and you represent the donors. So for me, my interactions with the board and the superintendent at that time was to encourage, like many other parents, transparency and a clear articulation of why things were going the way they were. So I don't take a strong advocacy role, particularly when I'm PI board president. I want to make sure the donors are getting the information they need and have an environment that they feel confident about. Now, for me, if I had been not in that role and on the board, and in that role, when you're in a governing position, I think there's a couple of things that feel like they could have gone differently. One would be when the board took the OCR resolution back in June, I had the opportunity to listen to that conversation and make up my own mind and think that that probably isn't the way I would have gone. Probably would have just moved on, trying to take the information from them and do better. I think going forward, one of the ways we help with transparency, healing wounds, getting the trust back is to make board meetings more user-friendly so that they're not quite so long and it's not quite so hard to have your voice heard. And then to make sure we implement other mechanisms that help us get voice into the process, because not all parents can come at night, and some of them have to give you input in other ways. So I think it's really important to feel that way.
And looking ahead a little bit more?
So as part of the healing and rebuilding trust process, transparency is key to our community, and I think we have ways that we can be more transparent about what we do, and our communications can be clearer, and our decision-making processes out of the board, and how we hold our superintendent and senior staff accountable is also important for us.
Thank you very much. Ken Dauber, you're next.
Yes, thanks again to the Weekly and to the JCC for hosting. I have been quite disappointed with the school board's handling of the U.S. Department of Education's Office for Civil Rights investigations. When the finding that the district had violated civil rights law first came to light, I and I think many other community members advocated for an open and transparent process where we could understand what had happened, how it was that our policies and procedures hadn't been followed in this case, what we could do to determine whether this was a systemic issue, and then move forward. You know, that is to face directly the facts, improve, and then go on, because every organization has fault, every organization has failure, and I think the measure of an effective organization is what it does next. And the board decided to go in the other direction. It really went underground, I think, into a series of closed meetings, and then emerged a year and a half later with this resolution opposing the OCR's investigations, and really, I think, missing the opportunity to do what many of us wanted to do. And I think that one of the things that I did during that period was to really be a strong voice in the community for cooperation. I published an editorial in the Weekly on that subject, and I spoke probably a dozen times to the school board urging that. I think that in terms of going forward, I would say a couple of things. First, closed meetings are a bad idea unless you have a really good reason for it, because it disconnects the board from the community. And second, I would look at the relationship between the board and special education families and try to improve that, because I think that that was a source of a lot of the distrust that really that emerged during that period.
Thank you, Ken Dauber. And if you've been paying attention, you know that our final speaker on this question will be Catherine Crystal Foster.
In order to answer this question, it's important for us to focus on exactly what the role of the board is. The role of the board is to set policy for the district, to hire and fire the superintendent, and then it has an additional role of setting the overall tone and face of the school district. Looking at the way the board had carried out the functions that it has, I would, like my colleague Gina, give somewhat mixed reviews. I do believe that the school board in setting some broader policy and coming up with a strategic plan, a very fully featured, really robust strategic plan, has done a tremendous service to our district and is giving us the groundwork, putting the groundwork in place for us to do some really innovative and interesting things going forward, and allowing us to come together as a district, allowing the different schools to align, and allowing the parent community and the student community to understand where we're going. Where I feel that we've also done well is with respect to other policies we've put in place. For example, we now have a homework policy, which we need to evaluate, but we do have one. Where I've been less positive about where the board has gone is the lack of transparency that I saw with respect to some of the initial decisions regarding the Office of Civil Rights. I believe that the board is committed to protecting civil rights, but I do believe that the way in which they communicated with the community indicated that they did not, suggested perhaps that they were not as aligned as they are.
Thank you all very much. Our next question, and we'll shift now to 60 seconds for these questions, unless otherwise noted. Earlier this year, the Palo Alto High School principal, with the support of the superintendent, brought forth a recommendation to eliminate laning in freshman English. How would you have voted on this proposal? And using this issue as an example, could you share your views on when the school board's approval should be required for curriculum or teaching changes or other innovations that have been proposed by teaching professionals? Our first answer will be Terry Godfrey.
Okay, so my children happen to go to Pali, so this was a topic of interest of mine. The situation was unfortunate that teachers could have spent so much time trying to figure out what they felt was best for the kids in the ninth grade and what would be best for the class going forward. They seem to be a little disconnected and out of the loop with the district staff or to the district office, and I don't think that has anything to do necessarily with the teachers themselves. There was some communication there that just wasn't obvious, and so coming to the board with a well-thought-out plan that the board rejects is unfortunate. So I would say that we want those decisions to be at the teacher level, but we want them to come with the definition of what hurdles are before them and how they would get over those hurdles, like budget or other sorts of things, how to support all the kids, and that we want those kinds of decisions coming from the people who are closest to the students. In this case, I have a red light. In this case, I think that a lot of time was wasted, and that going forward, the kinds of decisions that happen at the board would be more systemic and district-wide, and the school-based decisions, we should trust our teachers to be able to do that.
Thank you very much. Gina Dalma.
This decision happened last February, and I submitted a guest opinion to the Palo Alto Weekly about it because I cared very deeply about it, and the board's actions it disappointed me because of two things. The first reason is, again, as Terry's saying, it was a proposal from those innovators at the front line that really were looking for an opportunity for all their kids to excel. We were labeling kids in a way that would really, truly have consequential consequences for them in terms of their belief system, of if they could achieve or not. These teachers described that their students in the lower lane were self-identifying as dummies. The second thing why it disappointed me is why not? Why not? Why don't we pilot something that is coming from the teachers, that is evidence-based? Let's try it out, let's measure it, see if it works, and if it works, let's scale it. In terms of the board, this is not a decision that should have reached the board. This is a decision that should have been decided at the school, at the district level. But that it was allowed to get into the board and the teachers treated in that way, I think was disappointing for our whole community.
Thank you very much. And I'm going to ask our timekeeper to raise that red flag a little bit higher and perhaps even wave it around as necessary. Okay. Jay Cabrera, you're up next.
I personally am not for oppose that particularly proposal. You know, obviously, as we seem to agree, we are very much so about empowering teachers, empowering the schools to be as successful as possible for the students. In the context of a good process, if something does need to go through the board, because I do agree that there must be a division between, you know, academic freedom and administrative processes, and the board's role shouldn't be to, you know, get involved in the academics of what's actually brought to the students. It should be more of an administrative level. And so in a general process, things that do need to come in front of the board should be blanket overall, you know, let's start this proposal out and get it initiated. It should never come to the board as a final proposal that's either shot down or shot up. The board should basically bless it before it even gets started so that it never even got to the point where it was pushed down. But yeah, definitely empowering teachers to be able to take control for themselves and their communities at the most local level possible.
Ken Dauber?
Well, I supported the teacher's proposal for the pilot delaning of English at Pali. I actually spoke the night of that proposal, and I think that was the right decision. And I supported it because the teachers had worked very hard over a period of years to address concerns expressed in our accreditation committee around low expectations in the basic lane of English and the fact that underrepresented minority students were concentrated in that basic lane. And so they had worked hard to raise the level, the expectations in the basic lane to the point where they were consistent with. They were the same as in the advanced lane. So I supported the teachers. They had evidence, they had data, and they were doing the right thing. In terms of the school board, I think that the school board has a role to play in curricular decisions. I think that the community has an interest in the curriculum that's being taught in the school. So I wouldn't draw a bright line there. I don't think that it was inconsistent with that the board saw it. I think that the way that the board handled it and handled the teacher's request, that's what I didn't agree with.
And Catherine Crystal Foster.
I was delighted to hear that the English teachers were getting together to plan together to try to meet the needs of all of the students at Pali. Where I think we ran into trouble with that proposal was the process by which it came to the board. The teachers had worked very hard on that proposal for a long period of time, but my understanding is that it had not been fully vetted by the superintendent. The special education community felt a bit blindsided and felt that their input had not been taken in the development of that proposal. And at some of the hearings, when asked, the teachers said that there was a lot of information that they had not yet gathered that they would like to have in order to learn how best to implement that proposal. So my feeling is a proposal of that nature is appropriate to come to the board, particularly when making a distinct difference between our two high schools. Whenever we have a policy that's going to be very different at Pali than at Gunn, we need to talk about that. Pali has a wider achievement gap than Gunn does. So changing Pali to be less like Gunn raised some questions that I'm hoping that we could answer in the future.
Thank you very much. The next question is, individual school sites in the Palo Alto Unified School District often operate somewhat autonomously under a framework of site-based decision-making. In the view of some, this bottom-up philosophy has allowed for innovation and local school flexibility. In the view of others, it may have resulted in inconsistencies and inefficiencies, including different bullying prevention programs, disciplinary and cheating policies, high school counseling programs, school handbooks, websites, and differences in other areas. Parents with children at two or more different schools can experience different rules, procedures, programs, and bell schedules. What changes, if any, do you support to this model? When and how should inconsistent practices or variations in programs be evaluated for effectiveness and either implemented across all district schools as a best practice or terminated? Again, what changes, if any, do you support to this model? When and how should inconsistent practices be evaluated for effectiveness and then either implemented across all schools in the district as a best practice or terminated? Ken Dauber.
Oh, so I heard Dr. McGee say yesterday that consistency is good for kids. And I agree with him, and he said it, I think, because we want to make sure, first of all, that we have a district in which our guiding philosophy actually guides the work of individual staff members in the district. So we want to have a vision that is actually effective across the district. And second, we want to make sure that We provide every child in the district the best that our district has to offer, no matter what school they go to or what teacher they have. The point of having a unified district with over 12,000 students isn't just administrative convenience, it's getting the benefit of those best practices and innovation. So the key to this is evaluation. If we see inconsistent practices across the district, we should evaluate them for their success in promoting teaching and learning, and we should identify the ones that are working, and we should be working to propagate those across the district. And in areas where they aren't working, we should be transforming them into something that we know works better, that is a best practice.
Thank you. Catherine Crystal Foster.
We have a culture in Palo Alto of this level of autonomy in our school sites, and there's both beauty to that and a cost. What works well there is that you can let creativity and innovation bloom. What works less well is it can create the kind of inconsistency that creates sometimes concern, sometimes confusion, sometimes resentment among students and teachers. Students and families. I believe that we have a situation where if we have inefficiencies where we're constantly recreating the wheel every time we innovate somewhere else in the district, that points to changing the approach that we take toward the site-based autonomy. I think when we have issues that relate to student safety, student health, or legal mandates, it's imperative that we have consistency across the district. We need to enable our teachers, however, to be able to innovate where they can. And like Ken, I truly believe that we need to evaluate every time we bring a pilot forward in our school district.
All right. Jay Cabrera.
On page 25 of the massively interesting strategic plan assessment, it's all the data analysis. They asked everybody, who makes their decisions for what reasons, and the top amount of decision-making power that everybody gave to specifically the board was 55%. So at best, any decision that is made by the board really is a 50-50, collaboration with the local schools. And so I'm a very big supporter of autonomy for the schools. And if there is a specific program that needs to be implemented at an individual school, it should be able to be proven why it needs to be implemented at that school, and the school should want to implement it because the board can prove that it needs to be implemented. And in that context, if they need resources to do that, that's where the board comes in. The board is responsible for ensuring that the resources are provided to the local schools to make sure that they're getting what they need to be able to implement the programs. What I don't want to see is a little mini No Child Left Behind, where at our little local level, everyone has to do exactly the same at all the other schools, and you're forced in these little boxes.
Thank you very much. Terry Godfrey.
Thank you. So I agree with much of what's been said here. We have thousands of decisions made every day in our district. And if we're a student-centered district, we want most of those decisions being made closest to the students. With that said, I come from a work environment that is similar. I grew up at Intel, and we had a very large decentralized operation. And we had a model by which decisions that had to do with health, safety, product consistency and quality, those were copy exact. Other decisions that were closer to home, as long as they had outcomes that were defined and those outcomes were agreed to, you had some leeway within the organization you worked in or the site you worked at to get to the right answer. So in my mind, we would do ourselves a service by defining that model for us as PAUSD and deciding which of those decisions are copy exact and which of those decisions are made closest to the student, are made best, and that as long as the outcomes are within the outcomes that we've defined, then it's fine.
And Gina Dalma.
So my day job is I have the privilege of managing the Silicon Valley Community Foundation's investment in education. And through that lens, we're always looking at scalability. What scales, right? And that is the key question. For the school district, I think that innovation truly comes at the very local level. But unless we're documenting what that innovation is, evaluating, making sure that it's that we are understand what it means in terms of student achievement, and if it's scalable, then you know then it's not innovation won't serve. It will only serve that specific set of kids. We need to be looking at creating a learning institution where we foster innovation, we embrace innovation, but we truly are measuring it, seeing if it scales, and then the district's role is creating these continuous improvement cycles at every level so it's scaled appropriately. I believe in consistency to serve every kid.
Thank you very much. Next question, Common Core. Heralded by some as an important and innovative step in strengthening curriculum across the country, as well as performance standards. Critiqued by others as a disruptive and harmful intrusion on local school autonomy and control. Candidates, could you tell us what are your views about Common Core? Are you an enthusiastic supporter or are you a skeptic? Do you have concerns about standardized testing? And if so, how might those standardized test concerns be addressed as new assessment tools are developed for Common Core? Common Core. Ken Dowler.
I'm an enthusiastic supporter of the Common Core. I think it's good news for Palo Alto. I think it's good news nationally. I think it's particularly good news for Palo Alto because it's consistent with what we want for our kids in Palo Alto. That is, we want kids who can think critically, synthesize information, reach across disciplines. That's really the animating principle of the Common Core. And so I think from that perspective, it's terrific. Critical thinking and writing are 21st century skills, and you know we should be on board with that. And certainly, given that we have standards tests, and we should have standards tests because we want to make sure that that our schools are accountable, those tests should be aligned with what we want our kids to learn. And so I think the Common Core is closer to that. Supporting teachers in this transition is important. I'm hearing from teachers that they're excited as well, but that they want to make sure that the resources are there when they need them. And as a board member, I would certainly commit to that. And in areas where we do need to make progress in the district, I think the Common Core is a good spur to action by pointing us to look again, take another look at the curriculum to make sure we're doing best for the kids.
Thank you. Terry Godfrey.
So I'm also a supporter of Common Core. It's the first in decades, probably first federal curriculum standards that we've seen. And of course, California has adopted it, so we're doing it. I think it's got a component to it that is a little bit newer to some of the other districts around us, but I think for us, we've always had the back and forth interplay with teachers and students about why does that work that way and how does that really work and can you reverse engineer that? And I think there's a lot of value in that. I spent a lot of time tutoring geometry in college, and there's a lot of value in making sure people understand what's in there. As far as the testing goes, it's not clear to me when the testing's available. I think we've heard that it'll be next fall, but that's maybe at risk. So we do need to keep ourselves on track, understanding our kids, where they are, how our schools are doing, and then be prepared when it shows up. It's technology-based. That might be a little bit of an issue for some of the kids who don't spend as much technology time as others. But I think overall, our teachers are enthusiastic about it, and the district to date has done a good job of giving them some time and space to prepare.
Thank you very much. Catherine Crystal Foster.
I'm also rather bullish on the Common Core state standards for a number of different reasons. They were developed by experts over a period of time in order to ensure that our students would be able to be the kinds of critical thinkers and continuous learners that we need in this economy at this time. I work in education policy and have for decades, and so this is the kind of thing that I've been looking at and seeing for a long time. I'm very excited about the opportunity for our students to be exposed to this. I think that the other reasons why I'm excited about it is the teachers are excited about it. The teachers are using this as an opportunity to learn. They're using it as an opportunity to examine their practices, and we as a district can take it as an opportunity to dig even deeper on a whole range of subjects to say, we're examining our curriculum, we're doing more critical thinking, we're asking our students to read different things and to approach math differently. Let's really use this as an opportunity to transform some of our learning. I believe that...
Gina Dalma.
So they are incredibly excited, and I am as this is the single most important education reform of the past decades for our state. And what other candidates have said in terms of what the Common Core State Standard really mean is truly a focus on key 21st century skills. And you've heard that term a lot, but what they mean is that our kids will be able to better communicate, collaborate, create, do critical thinking, the type of skills that we want to make sure they're solving the challenging problems that they're going to face when they graduate. I have the privilege of being on the steering committee of the National Funders Network that's investing in Common Core. So I'm able to see practices nationwide. There's several states that are far ahead of us. And what this looks like in the classroom is the classrooms are noisy. The kids are discussing issues. They're solving problems together. And the teacher is not the sage in the stage. She's basically facilitating the conversation. Imagine the excitement for both learning and teaching of this type of environment.
Thank you very much. And that brings us to Jacob Rare.
Standard testing certainly isn't going away anytime soon. And so any improvement on our standardized testing and curriculum is amazing and awesome. We all love it. For me, I did talk to a lot of students, not a lot, but 10 or 15 students the other day when we were at Gunn. And they told me over and over and over again that they feel completely prepared academically. What they need is real world skills, just general real world street skills, how to pay taxes, how to deal with finances, how to get an apartment, things like that. And so I feel like the students here in Palo Alto will benefit greatly from Common Core, but we as a board must be critical in its implementation to ensure that there are excessive assessments, making sure that as it's implemented over the years, we'd be 5 years out to assess it in detail and apply it towards what students need and what students want, and of course what parents want and our community needs to hold the whole system accountable, and then obviously report that back to the state level and make sure that things are adjusted over time so they can get better.
Thank you very much. Here's the next question. In June, the school board adopted a resolution that criticized the Federal Office for Civil Rights handling of its investigations in the Palo Alto Unified School District, made allegations of evidence tampering, and committed the district to working with elected officials and national education groups to lobbying for change to OCR practices. Two questions, and let's try and do this crisply, and let's call it 30 seconds here. So how would you have voted on this resolution and why? And if you're a board member, that means yes or no. So how would you have voted on this resolution and why? And do you support the use of district financial resources and other resources to lobby for changes in OCR's authority and investigative practices as called for in the resolution? So, Catherine Crystal Foster, how would you have voted on this resolution and why? And do you support the use of resources to lobby for changes in OCR's authority and investigative practices?
Without knowing all of the confidential student-focused information that was in front of the board, the proceedings that no one in this room had had information about, I don't feel that I'm in a position to opine one way or the other. I think it is very concerning that the school board felt that it needed to pass that resolution, and I think that the allegations in that resolution are also of great concern. I would vote yes very reluctantly, but if the allegations in it were true.
Gina Dalma.
I would would not have voted yes for the resolution. I would have voted no, and I would have also voted no in terms of investing resources in fighting the OCR's process.
Jay Cabrera.
Most likely would have voted for as much transparency as possible, if not more transparency, which brings it more to a no in the context of, what had happened, as far as lobbying for changes, specifically, I do believe the board can be involved in lobbying and as a direct, conduit from the local level to, county and state, and that it's important to do that. Whether they should lobby on this specific issue is really up to the community to decide.
Ken Dauber.
Well, I would have voted no, and I said so at the time, and that's because, for two reasons. First, the details of the resolution, allegations of evidence tampering and so forth, were just inconsistent with the facts as they were known. And this is, I disagree with Catherine. I think that the facts in evidence were clear. The board published the ones that they said that their decision was based on. This was a clear decision from my perspective, and I think that the community values on civil rights were just diametrically opposed to the resolution. Was there a second half, Joe, that I missed?
I think we're going to say time and go to Terry Godfrey. Thank you.
So when I listened to the board meeting in June, the board's frustration was palpable, and I can understand how they got to where they were. I would not have voted to support it. Much of the discussion was about changing process and improving process. So while I wouldn't want to spend legal fees and spend a lot of resources trying to figure out how to change the OCR, there are times when an agency with which you have a close relationship and wants to do a better job asks for input. You might participate in a postmortem with other districts or something like that in order to give them input in a constructive way, much like they're giving us input in a constructive way.
All right. I know from experience that being a candidate and sitting on this stage can be a stressful experience, but let's talk about student stress. Do you like the way we segued there? Is the district doing too little, too much, or about the right amount to address student stress, the competitive high school environment, and the emotional and social well-being of its students? Is the district doing too little, too much, or about right? And if it's too little, what further steps or programs would you advocate? If it's too much, what do you think should be scaled back? Terry Godfrey.
So we have been talking about stress for quite a long time. Of course, there's the good stress where the tiger's chasing you in the jungle and you want to get away. But this kind of academic stress that weighs heavily on our children is something that we've been working on for a while. Things like a homework policy that actually rolls out and gets implemented should help. These things take time to roll through the system. And eventually we'll get there. And of course, it doesn't cover honors or AP classes, so perhaps that's not perfect, but it's an improvement. Project stacking, test stacking, all those kinds of things that happen when teachers are doing their own thing and they don't have really the time and space to plan with other teachers, could go a long way to helping the stress on kids as well. And then the other thing that I hear is inconsistent horizontal teaching. So if you have a class, you have English 10 and Ken has English 10 and he's doing a little bit of homework and I'm doing a lot of homework and he's getting an A and I'm getting a B, is really stress-inducing for high school students. And it doesn't seem like it ought to be, but it is. So I think investing resources to our teachers so they can work together and get that horizontal consistency right is really important.
Thank you very much. Gina Dalma, student stress.
So I think our kids, especially in the high schools, are impacted by an incredible amount of stress. And that stress comes from peer pressure, parent pressure, our community, our schools. So the first thing that I would do is, I think we have to do more, by the way, and the first thing that we need to do is have a community conversation. What do we believe, what do we mean by social, emotional, academic success for our students? We need to make sure that we're building the skills of our students that are the what they're called the non-cognitive, right? The productive persistence, the skills that would help them prepare them for life, not only for academic success. I think that we've done a lot in terms of homework policy, but the policy is not applied consistently. But more than anything, what do we value as a community in terms of what we're providing our students to make make them successful and to provide an environment where they can thrive. And they're driven, they're driving their learning by their own passion. So I think that there's a lot that we can do as a school district to assure that we're providing this environment for our kids.
Thank you very much. Jay Cabrera, student stress.
Yeah, the stress is never going away, and it's like our society puts immense amounts of stress on students. When you're a student, you feel that. And so there's no perfect way, and we're never going to be perfect on it, so we have to push ourselves to the limit every single time. Some of the controversies earlier, previous years, in terms of implementing at one of the schools, making sure that everything is done and rolled in over a course of time, and there's a process to make sure that counselors aren't overwhelmed with it with fast changes, so that it's as smooth as possible for the students who are receiving those new types of counseling. As far as counseling goes, that's only one component. I really agree with Gina over here about how it's really community involvement. And one of the biggest issues that came up in the assessment for the strategic plan was that the biggest gap was the parent stress on the kids versus the kids' interpretation of the parent stress. And so there really is a role for parents to play in alleviating stress as well as the community. The only other thing I'll say is that it's important for extracurricular activities and getting students out of the classroom for stress relief.
Thank you very much. Catherine Crystal Foster.
Our students are under a tremendous amount of stress, and that becomes clear in every survey, every conversation that I've had with students, with graduates. There is a certain amount of stress, as has been discussed before, that can be positive, that can be motivating, that moves students forward. But then we've also learned, and current research has shown, that students' attitude towards stress also will affect their ability to cope with it. What we need to do as a district is to help our students become more resilient and be able to cope with their stress and to deal with it. And we need to eliminate stress that is unnecessary on our students. Part of the work that we need to do as a district is to take a hard look at the way our homework policies are being implemented, the way our test stacking and project stacking is working in Pali, for example, with the block schedule, and in Gunn, which does not have it. And we need to figure out how we can ensure that everything that we do for our students that adds to their stress is something that's also adding to their learning.
Thank you very much. And that brings us to Ken Dower, student stress.
Well, we don't have to answer this question ourselves. Our students think that we're doing too little about stress in the schools. 25% of students in the last strategic plan survey said that they were dissatisfied with the social-emotional climate at school. 87% 5 years ago said that homework was a big stressor for them. So the good news is that we have a community plan for dealing with this, Project Safety Net, P8. Some of you have heard me. I've probably talked about P8 more than a lot. And that's the supportive school environments. And it's a plan for addressing homework and test and project scheduling and guidance counseling and curriculum. If we enact that plan, and if we work that plan, as I and many others in the community have been urging for years, we will make progress on this. We did have a district homework committee. I advocated for it. I served on it. As others have pointed out, the next step is to put some metrics and measurement around it and see if we are actually affecting the level of homework in our classrooms, for example. This is an issue that if we work it, we will make progress. If we don't, we'll get more of the same, and our students will continue to suffer the ill health effects of excessive stress.
Thank you very much. And the seventh and final question from the Palo Alto Weekly and its team. Palo Alto has struggled to make consistent progress at closing the achievement gap, and it is generally agreed that too many students are entering high school unprepared for the rigor of high school curriculum. What initiatives would you support in our middle schools to address these problems? Achievement gap, high school readiness, what initiatives would you support in our middle schools to address these problems? Terry Godfrey.
So when I think about the achievement gap, one of the ways it shows itself in our district is which kids graduate with the ADG requirements completed and which don't. So as I know most of you know, the ADG requirements are the requirements for UC schools. Just for the class of 2016, those are required for our students, but before that they weren't. So for us it was a measure of who was graduating college ready. You won't be surprised to know, given the question, that our underrepresented minorities were graduating college ready at a lower rate than our white and Asian students, and that the data suggests that, there's a very high correlation between that and early education and how they do on those standardized tests we have back in the grades 3 to 8. So I understand that the district has made some conscious decisions and efforts around that, and you can see that gap closing, but middle school is a tumultuous time for anyone. And when you have the extra added burdens that come with that achievement gap, it's a place that we want to spend more resources and more time helping those kids, identifying them, and making sure they've got the support they need.
Thank you very much. Catherine Crystal Foster.
Our achievement gap in Palo Alto is really a shame on the district, and I feel that it's something that we need to address aggressively. Middle school is too late. The achievement gap starts well before middle school. There's a lot that we can do in middle school, but what I think is most important is for us to understand and unpack all of the factors that lead to the achievement gap that we have. We have a number of different programs in our district that we employ in order to address achievement gap issues. But what we don't have is a comprehensive catalog of those, and we do not have a full set of evaluations and information about what's working. What are we doing to reach the kids who are falling behind? Where are we doing well by those kids? Are there elementary schools that are doing better? Are there different practices that we bring to bear? This is where it's very important for us to think about how we can take all of the different initiatives that are happening throughout the district and taking a look at them and saying, where are we making a difference for our kids?
Thank you very much. Gina Dalma.
So I'm incredibly proud that we have a strategic plan. That strategic plan has one thing that I seriously disagree with. It says 85% of our kids will be proficient at the end of the 5 years. That's not okay. 100% of our kids should be proficient. Our kids are performing, our socioeconomically disadvantaged and kids of color are performing worse than some of the school districts around our region that have much higher levels of socioeconomically disadvantaged children. I agree with you, it's a shame. There's three things that are creating this achievement gap. The first one is belief system. We do not have the same expectation for all kids. I would very seriously work to assure that we have the same level of expectation and rigorous curriculum for all our students. The second thing is we've got to assure that we're connecting with those schools that know how to do it, that have closed the achievement gap.
Thank you very much. And our next candidate is Ken Dauber.
So I have worked hard in the district on first shining a light on the achievement gap and then on supporting concrete policies like the alignment of our high school graduation requirements with the A to G requirements to raise expectations for students. In terms of middle school, I think that there's a range of things that we can do. First of them is data and metrics. I mean, understanding what the problem is really critical to addressing it. The point that Gina raised about that we do worse than other districts in some areas for some kids, that's a wake-up call. And we have great teachers in our district and committed teachers, and when they see data like that, they get after it and try to figure out what to do about it. A growth mentality in our schools. Carol Dweck at Stanford, right across the street, has shown that if you tell kids that if they work hard, they can do better, they do better. And that we can create that teaching style in our teachers with professional development. So I would support that.
And I'll say thank you at that point, if I may, and go to Jay Cabrera.
I think this is a perfect example of where we really need to build a broad community discussion and get input from students and staff and teachers and parents and community members. And you know, there's certainly a lot of ideas. Obviously, one key thing is that the middle schools are creating a bottleneck in the context where there seems to be just barely enough elementary school space, and there's more than enough high school space. But the bottleneck seems to be at the middle schools. So how can we increase middle school space and reduce class size back down to like 20 per student? So that would be one possible option. The other thing I want to say is I feel like there's a lack of leadership in the context, like, if you look at the board and you look at the people running for the board, we are not the people who should be the leaders in pushing this issue, right? That we need to be empowering, faculty and staff and students who are, directly involved in the communities with funds and staff and support to build communities and build community discussion to, build a leadership committee to make it happen.
Thank you very much. And that completes the seven question set from the Palo Alto Weekly. We're going to go on now to questions from the candidates. Each of the candidates has been asked to submit a question that they would like to ask of the other candidates. We're going to take the questions at random, and then we're going to get the answers in a random order. We're going to give 90 seconds for this particular opportunity, and eventually we will have heard from all five of the candidates responding to all five of the questions. And again, the questioner will actually get the last word to share his or her own thoughts about the question that they've asked. So, the first question comes from Terry Godfrey, and her question is as follows. There's a great saying in this town, there are only two kinds of kids we care about around here, those we're related to and those we aren't. With that in mind, please share one or two things you're proud of that you've done with and for our community's youth. Please share one or two things you're proud of that you've done with and for our community's youth. And the first respondent will be Catherine Crystal Foster.
That's a great question, Terry. Thank you. I like the questions that get to the heart of what we're about here. I would call out two different things. One is, until recently, I was the executive director of the Peninsula College Fund, a nonprofit that helps low-income, first-generation college students finish college. And one of my proudest legacies is expanding that program so that it would serve the young people of Palo Alto's high schools, so that students who go to Pali and Gunn, who are not as advantaged as many of their peers, would have the opportunity to have a scholarship, a mentor, training, and internships when they go to college. So that's something that I'm very proud of giving to the young people of this town. Another thing that I would call out would be the work that I have done through PI. I was on the first PI board, and as a member of that first board, we had the very difficult job of convincing people that pooled fundraising that would benefit all the students in our district would in fact create a whole that was bigger than the sum of its parts. So I worked very hard on that was the representative for my elementary school, had the highest percentage participation of all of the schools that first year, and we were able to return substantial funds to our students, which got aids in the classrooms and art programs and many other things that helped many young people thrive in our schools.
Thank you very much. Jay Cabrera, please share one or two things that you're proud of that you've done with and for our community's youth.
So my perspective is a little different. I graduated from Gunn High School in 1998 and went to UC Santa Cruz and have recently boomeranged back with the parents and living here in Palo Alto, in Stanford, in Palo Alto. So in that context of working with students and working with the community, obviously I've been extremely involved in Santa Cruz as well as on Stanford campus working with college students. When I'm thinking of high school students in lower, I'm thinking about, back in the days where I'd go and visit with friends and go have fun, go to the parks and a slightly different component. But one of the things I do is I work in a community nonprofit that I helped start. And we have a variety of programs because we're an umbrella nonprofit. But our biggest one, it's not huge, it's about $20,000, $30,000 a year, is called Digital Storytellers. And we do at-risk youth education in Oakland and Richmond. And so that particular program teaches poetry with the students, gets them excited about it, including slam poetry, and then does digital recording of it and teaches digital editing skills in the classroom with at-risk youth. So it's really cool. I'm obviously more involved in the back end of it with the finances and the grants and everything here in Palo Alto. But we support staff and teachers in the Oakland, Richmond.
Thank you very much. Gina Dalma.
So first, I want to thank both Terry and Catherine for their incredible work on PI. I think it's a huge community asset. I have not been involved in PI except as a donor. My involvement in Palo Alto has been through, I've been involved in site council at Ohlone, and I so appreciate that Susan Charles, the principal during the site council days, is here. I've been involved in the WASC process at Pali. But the thing that I'm proudest of is we started a group for Spanish-speaking parents at Pali. And this is a group that has not been, that was not represented at our high school. And through this group, we have two focuses. The first one is assuring that we are getting the information to make sure that Latino kids and Spanish-speaking kids at Pali are successful. But more importantly, we're hoping that through this process, we're able to inform the programs, the information, and truly the policies at Pali to assure that that we close the achievement gap with our Latino kids in our high school.
Ken Dauber.
Well, there's some fun stuff, like I was chairman of my son's Cub Scout pack and stuff like that, but I'm not, that doesn't seem like service, that just seems like fun to me. What I would, the area that I've really focused on in terms of kids is to try to advocate for actually doing the things that our community I think wants to do, has in its vision and so forth for kids, particularly in the area of social emotional well-being and lifting up kids' achievement. So I served on the district's homework committee after advocating for it. I serve on the district's local control accountability plan, which is about, you know, making sure that we use our assets to lift up kids who need help. Work on the Project Safety Net Community Engagement Committee. I've gone to I don't know how many board meetings and put together I don't know how much data, really to make the point that that our kids, even though they're doing well in many cases, and even though we have a great school district, still need more from us. And the things that we can do around homework and test and project scheduling and so forth. I don't want to sound like a broken record, but these are the things that affect kids' lives at school. And my sort of passion and my commitment has been around carrying that ball forward. Because, you know, if we can make these concrete changes, you know, we can make real changes in kids' lives. I think we've you know, done some great things in that area. I've been proud to be a part of that, and I hope to continue to do that.
Thank you very much. And we conclude with Terry Godfrey. Terry, it was your question, so I'm guessing you have a good answer to the question. please share one or two things you're proud of that you've done with and for our community's youth.
I don't know if I have a great answer, but I wanted to hear what these guys had to say, because I want to make sure we're student-centered and we always think about our youth and bring it back to our youth. For me, I've been in this community for 15 years, and the last 10 years or so, I took my professional experience as a senior manager and put that to use on behalf of kids, as PTA Council President, as a founder and leader in Project Safety Net, as the PI Board President, in ways that my senior management experience makes things happen for kids. But on the fun side, and the more fun side, is I've been the chair of the Developmental Assets Committee, which is a subcommittee of Project Safety Net, which we did a lot of work around figuring out what assets our kids had and then trying to go fill those gaps. And so I get the pleasure of taking the opportunity to just work with kids on things that help build their assets. And the assets I'm particularly interested in are caring neighborhoods and community values youth and youth as resources and caring adults in ways that we just give our kids a big, you know, inclusive, bring them in, make them feel like they're part of the community, and we build assets for them. My quick example as of those things I've done, the one that is on my mind is I did a Caring Neighbors team this summer with about a dozen kids, and we met every week, and we did events across the city, and there were times when I thought, I do not have time for this. How am I fitting this in? This is killing me, because managing a dozen teens is hard. But I'm going to read you an email that I got right at Labor Day weekend that made it worth it. Thank you so much, Terry. I really enjoyed serving for you. As a matter of fact, my brother was a person who initially did not like doing service, but he came along with me. He started loving it more and more as the days went on. I loved doing this because I had the chance to talk to so many people at events. The last block party we went to highlighted my services in, because not only were the people there hospitable and accepting, they enjoyed talking to us about community. By the way, one of the women who attended was one that we saw at one of those first meetings with the city, and she recognized my brother and me. I hope to see you at the ribbon cutting in next summer to continue furthering our goals. Sincerely, A.
Thank you. All right. The next question will come from Jay Cabrera. And here is his question. What one program or service in the school budget do you believe should be reconsidered and possibly cut? And what one new program or service would you like to see added? What would you like to see reconsidered or cut? And perhaps what new program or service would you like to see added? And the first respondent will be Catherine Crystal Foster.
That's an interesting question. I have to think about, I don't know that I could identify right at this moment something that I would like to see cut. We have been trying to do quite a bit of belt tightening over the past few years. We are looking at a situation now where we have all kinds of escalating pension costs and other costs. So we are going to need to be making some hard decisions. I don't know that I could identify at this moment a program that I would cut. In terms of things that I would like to add, I'm very interested in seeing additional funds put forward for three things. I have to choose which would be first. One is I believe that we need to invest much more in our evaluation work as a district. I believe that we need to invest more in innovative curriculum and interdisciplinary curriculum, and I'd like to see us invest more in foreign language instruction.
Thank you very much. That takes us to Ken Dauber. What one program or service might be reconsidered and possibly cut, and what one new program or service would you like to see added? Ken Dauber.
So the area where I think we clearly should be making cuts is in our expenditures for outside legal fees. There may be a future for me in politics, Joe.
Yeah. Our
expenditures on legal fees, particularly around litigating with special ed families and also around the Office for Civil Rights, have just exploded over the last 5 or 6 years. One firm went from $25,000 5 years ago to over $250,000 in the last year. I was recently looking at a case where we were fighting a family over the failure of the district to provide Spanish translations of special education documents. And the judge said, you know, I don't know.
I'm going to ask everybody to hold off on their applause, in part because it takes time away from the responses, and in part because it's only a few steps till we get to the World Wrestling Federation climate here that we're trying to avoid. So thank you. Go ahead, and Mr. Dauber, that does not take time away from your clock.
A case where the judge said ultimately, I don't know why you're fighting this in any way, we're violating the education code, you need to provide the Spanish translations. You know, we need a much more cooperative relationship with our special education families, and we need to take the money that we're spending on legal fees and put it into services for kids. And that just seems to me to be a obvious and straightforward correction that we need to make. And in terms of increasing funding, I think we should have foreign language instruction for all of our elementary school students, K through 5, whether they are in an immersion program or not. That's something that parents in Palo Alto have wanted for a long time. There's solid evidence that that helps language learning and also general intellectual development. It's not an expensive item, but I can't imagine, frankly, a higher impact change that we can make for those dollars.
Thank you very much. Terry Godfrey?
On the side of what we might cut, years ago, back when the economic downturn hit, we made some decisions at that time. We went out and surveyed the parent community so that there would be parent input into the process as well. And you won't be surprised to know that parents wanted cuts away from the students. So we know that we've added things back over the years. And so I would probably take sort of a similar look and look at the places that we decided that we were going to add back, but maybe we wouldn't want to. Legal fees seems like a good idea. Communications director might be a good idea, things like that. Places where we want to put money back into the classroom. And, you know, I hate to copy you, but I'm a Fless girl too. I was on the Foreign Language and Elementary Schools Task Force back in 2008. We presented at March 2008, just as the financial situation was crumbling, and we got a resounding no. So that has been on my mind since then. I'm not going to parrot what Ken just said about the research. It's obvious. It should be done. At the time, we suggested $1 million to start it in grades 3 to 5, and we got shot down. I will come back at this again many, many times. Perhaps we can do that together in whatever roles we end up in, because it's important. And as far as trying to figure out specifically what to cut, we have ways that we figure those things out. So. I'm interested to know what you have in mind, because all input is good input.
Gina Dalma.
So I think the first thing that I would cut is irrelevant teacher professional development. The first thing that I would add is meaningful teacher professional development. I think it's the single most important investment that we should make. We should make sure that our teachers are able to invest in themselves, have time to share with others, truly be the leaders at their field. They are the single most important leverage point for our students' success. So I think that we need to make sure that we are seriously aligning our budget to assure that we are investing in what we believe is the most valuable thing. The second thing is we've got Common Core. We've got to make serious decisions in terms of making sure that our teachers are ready, again, that we've got relevant instructional material, that we have a system to evaluate how kids are learning so we can fine-tune our teacher professional development. And then the foreign language, I think, is a no-brainer. Our community wants it. Our community needs it. And in this 21st century world, having monolingual children is truly a deficit. So I would definitely invest in that.
And that is time. Jacob Burr.
First of all, the budget information on the website is very limited. And we talked to the superintendent and the staff yesterday, and they're going to be putting on, I think they said 3 weeks, it's going to be an inch thick online of budget information, which we can comb through and find every little detail that we could potentially cut. I do feel that it's essential to, like you were saying, you know, belly tightening, to go through all the administrative details, see where we can cut things like legal fees and all the other details to provide that funding for the students and for the resources of the teachers, because it's so important. From there, there's so many possible ideas, but the key thing to remember is that we currently have a 3% mandate for budget reserves, and we have by the state, and we've instituted a 10% reserve within our Unified School District, and it's become almost 12, 13, even going on 15%. So there currently is almost $25 million in the reserves that could be budgeted towards things. So I'm a proponent of cutting the reserve, potentially even as low as 5%. Could be more, you know, but consider opening that money. Additionally, there's another $60 million of bond funds that have not been allocated. And there's so many different possibilities. One thing that I'm a big proponent of is, you know, teaching coding like a language, like English and reading, because students need to learn how to work with computers. I wish I had had that information to get into the future of the job markets going on now. And then from there, there's so many possibilities for really building a new school, you know, whether it's elementary school or even consider redoing Cubberly entirely to be more of a mixed space, but I'll stop there. Sure.
Thank you very much. The next question comes from Catherine Crystal Foster. How do you define success for our students? How do you define success for our students? Gina Dahlman.
I think that's a great question, and I have a 16-year-old in the audience that I think of the answer to that question very often. I define success as a social, emotional, and academic achievement of a child. When a child is driven to learn by their own passion, and they feel their own energy in terms of their learning, we have reached, you know, it is a successful child. When a child is ready to go home and further do research in terms of something that they're interested, that is success. We often put our ideas as a community, adult ideas in terms of what we mean for success, but truly having looking at my kids' eyes and seeing their eyes shine when they discover something, when they learn something, when they feel they can go further and contribute to our community, to our world, that is success.
Thank you very much. Ken Dauber, how do you define success for our students?
So in the last campaign, I talked a lot, and I'm talking a lot in this campaign, about our broad community desire, I think, and our shared vision to have schools where students thrive socially, emotionally, and academically. And I think the important word there is thrive. We want schools where students thrive. I know we want schools like that because, to a large extent, we have schools like that. I mean, our schools have great teachers. Those teachers hold our students in their hands, in their minds, in their hearts. And the work that we're doing is really around greater fulfillment of that mission. Now, the hard part is, you know, how do we make sure that we stay in that place, and how do we make sure that we get better? I'll repeat something that Dr. McGee said, our new superintendent said, that was quoted in the newspaper. He was rhapsodizing, as I did when I was there, about the Maker Studio at Barron Park. And he said it was an amazing space. Kids are using computers, they've got sewing machines, they've got blocks. It's fantastic to be there. And what Dr. McGee said is, but we still need to evaluate it, right? Because what we still need to know is it actually working? And the key to taking that vision that we share and turning it into reality is to always be asking, okay, what's the bottom line? What does the data say? How do we measure the goals that we have? Because that's what it means to take an aspiration and turn it into a reality.
Terry Godfrey, how do you define success for our students?
So when I think of our students, the kinds of students I like to see are engaged, resilient, and they persist in their learning. And I like to think that I don't get to define their success for them, that they each have their own definition of success. We have, on our campaign team, I have a lot of parents who are about my age and have kids who've just gone off to college in the last few weeks. And as I look around the table, one kid went off to Vanderbilt, one kid went off to the San Francisco Conservatory of Music, one kid went off to Harvard, one kid went off to Pitzer, and our campaign manager at UC Santa Barbara, and I think this is an awesome table of kids who have defined success for themselves, found their spark during their high school years of what was interesting to them, what made them come back to school every day, what made them be engaged and persist, and then took that and went someplace else with it and are going to go make a life with that. So I'd like to define my kids' success. However, I think they're going to do it, and I'm happy to live in a place where we make that environment possible.
Jay Cabrera, how do you define success for our students?
For me, it's a very, very simple answer, and it's the same of what we want our students to do for, you know, parents and for the community, is we want them to get an A, right? We want our students to get an A, and you know, for me, the way I like to describe it is 720 evaluation, you know, when I evaluate or full circle and up and down. And so at the Gunn High School, we had the forum there last week. I went and talked about, you know, a dozen, maybe 15 students, and, you know, interacted with them. And I asked them really simply, you know, how do you feel that the Palo Alto Unified School District has achieved, you know, success for you personally going out into the real world, getting the skills you need for college, getting the skills you need for life. And they were not giving us an A. and we need to have the students give us an A. The students need, I want to be able to go to a school, talk to students, and for them to tell me that, you know, they grade at least a B, and there should be some A's. There wasn't a single 90% or plus of any of the students I talked to grade the experience that they had in the Palo Alto Unified School District. The average was probably in the B range, the low B's, B minus. There was one student of the 15 I talked to who fell through the cracks, and, you know, so it averaged out to like a C+. But I feel like we have that duty to our students to be able anytime to just go to a school, talk to them, and to get a grade that is what we would expect for them. You know, and that's how I define success with students, is them to tell us that they are successful.
Thank you very much. And Catherine Crystal Foster, your question, how do you define success for our students?
Our students succeed when they can fulfill their own full potential in the classroom and in their lives beyond the classroom. I believe, and I think that this is shared by some of the other folks up here, that we cannot define success for our kids. They all need to define success in their own terms. And the success is about their personal best academically, but it's also about their personal best as independent thinkers, as resilient people, as people who value and are valued by their community. Our students can be successful when they can fail, when they feel that they've had the opportunity to fail and they've had the opportunity to pick themselves back up again, when they've gotten that level of support and independence that enables them to do that. Our students also are successful when we give them what they need in order to feed their own passions and find what it is that drives them. When our students are looking to soar, and we can help them fly. No matter how high they want to go, if that's where they want to go, if that feeds their passion, let's let them try. If they need our help, then we give them the tools so that they can succeed again on their own terms. When our students can learn to both compete and be cooperative, when they can be their own individual people who can learn throughout their lives and become learners from the day that they leave our schools until they raise children of their own, then we know that our children have succeeded.
Thank you very much. Our next question is from Gina Dalma. What are the educational innovations taking place outside of our district that you're most excited about considering for Palo Alto? Educational innovations taking place outside of our district that you are most excited about considering for Palo Alto. Catherine Crystal Foster, back to you.
That's a really interesting question. Because I've done all of my professional work in the child advocacy and education policy space, I've had the privilege of being able to see all kinds of innovations happening elsewhere in other districts. And I'm really excited to see some things that come to mind for me have to do with if you look in New York and you can see that there's some public schools who have partnerships with the research institutions where they are, and students can do more independent research with business and with universities. I'm very excited about some of the internship programs that I've seen in the high school level in places like North Carolina. I've worked with some youth organizers in Philadelphia who've done some absolutely fantastic participatory action research where the students learn both research skills and debating skills and kind of personal advocacy skills in order to create plans for the futures of their own schools, and I think those are fantastic. I'm also really interested in some of the early world language programs that I've seen in elementary schools in a number of different places. And last, really, really energized by some of the early Common Core adaptations that I've seen through the Core to College work that I was doing with the Gates Foundation in a number of states throughout the country so that the kids' exit doors from high school align better with the entry doors to college.
Thank you. Terry Godfrey?
I'm going to include one that's happening in our district. I know that's not exactly the question, but I'll get to that one at the end. So the other places around the country where I've seen things that are interesting are sometimes districts we benchmark ourselves against. Like in Scarsdale, New York, they have this Center for Innovation that's underway, which operates like a corporate R&D lab, and the students can be there in a lab environment, in a thinking environment, to do R&D kinds of work, which feels like one of those things that our students would be really receptive to. And in Nutrier, which is another one that we frequently benchmark ourselves against, they have a final project at the end of high school that includes a mentor from the community. It includes sponsorship in a way that has that, student advocating for themselves with an external person, giving them a different kind of a perspective, which I think our students also would be very open to and have a lot of advantages from having that sort of exposure and having that kind of a setup. And my shout out to our local program that I think is cool is the hybrid classes they have at Gunn, which they offer, that have the blended online learning with classroom learning, and sometimes they're outside the normal school day, but they have cool things like mobile games programming and cool history classes and such. And so as we've talked about trying to make sure we have those best practices shared, we have some right here that we'd be remiss if we didn't share.
Jay Cabrera.
I feel that one of the places where I wouldn't look to compare our school district is California and the United States, because California and the United States in many ways is ranked not the best in terms of schools in the world. And obviously Palo Alto is one of the best in California and in the United States. But I feel like it's really important to do really broad community studies and get everyone involved in looking at what's going on in the rest of the world. Our students that are coming out of Palo Alto must be ready for a globalized world. And the education that's happening in Europe and Asia is surpassing what we have in the United States. Whether we're talking about language or technical skills, or I'm also a big proponent of learning coding in schools. I feel that it starts with class size, reducing class size, increasing cost per student, right, in a larger context. And then that just brings up for me that in 2015, we as a community must rally around and repass the community funding initiative. I think 40% of all the money that runs our schools in Palo Alto comes from our community-owned community tax. And so we must repass that and even potentially increase it to build the resources for our students in a globalized world.
Thank you very much. Ken Dauber.
So I'll redefine the question a little bit or take issue with the premise. I don't think you're as interested in my ideas about educational innovations as you are in, as you should be, in the role that I as a board member and other board members can play in connecting our district to centers of excellence in innovation outside of the district. And that's something where I think we haven't done as well as we could and should. A former board member once described El Camino to me as the widest street in America, because even though you can see Stanford from the district office, there isn't a whole lot of connection between the district and the university. And we have a great world-class school of education there, but we don't have much presence of student teachers from Stanford in our secondary schools. We have a wealth of just knowledge about every particular, every subject under the earth across the street. We don't have as close connections to Foothill College as other communities do, and that's a connection that we should be nurturing. We're in the heart of Silicon Valley. We have centers of, innovation in all of these technology companies. I work at Google. Plenty of parents work in places where we can, bring that spirit and that interest into our schools. We have willing partners in our schools. I have talked to so many teachers who are eager for innovation, who are reaching out themselves to, Foothill and Stanford and so forth. The role of the board, I think, is to say we really do want to help build those bridges and empower those kinds of connections.
Thank you very much. And Gina Dalma, it was your question. What are the educational innovations taking place outside our district that you're most excited about considering for Palo Alto?
First, I want to thank Ken for his, I think he provided a great segue to my answer to the question, because you began with my conclusion, but I won't take that against you. I think why I asked this question is because I think that there's never been a more exciting time to be in the field of education. We've got a institutional framework that allows us incredible flexibility if we are to achieve the goal of 21st century learning, right? We've got a new funding formula that the state is giving us, which the great thing about this new funding formula is that it forces us to look at our budgeting in terms of our expected outcomes. Imagine that. We are learning, we have new research in terms of how the brain works and how students learn. And finally, we have education technology, which is changing the way we think about education, and it's truly blurring the difference between what you learn in school and what you learn at home. So within this context, I think that this is an opportunity for Palo Alto to truly be on the cutting edge and create the type of environment we want. Now I'm going to go into the innovations that I think are most exciting. And I'm not going to go that far. I'm going to go within our region because I really want you to visit it. The first innovative practice that I have loved seeing is Downtown College Prep. So, design thinking in school. Imagine that. Empower kids to solve challenging problems. And Evergreen Elementary in East Side of San Jose, making project-based learning a reality to truly empower kids and excite them to learn.
Thank you very much, and we'll shave a little off on your answer on the next question from Ken Dauber. The district has repeatedly delayed the opening of a 13th elementary school to respond to the increase in students over the past 20 years. What is your view on when a new school should be opened and where? Gina Dahlman. In 1 minute, please.
So, yes. We have the money. We are expected to be 16,000 students in 2025. We are going to keep on growing. We need to make sure that we are providing the appropriate infrastructure for our kids to learn. Overflow is which is, has been happening in a lot of our elementaries, really is not to the benefit of our students. There's been a proven impact on social emotional well-being of our kids because of overflow and because kids have to go to other schools. So yes, I would open another elementary. We do have the money, and I would build it exactly where our community is growing, which is mostly in south of Palo Alto, the south part of Palo Alto.
Jacob Rohr.
I have an interesting answer for this. When we learned about it, it seems that the bottleneck potentially is in the middle schools, but obviously it'd be great to have a new elementary school too. We could always pass on their ballot measure, but the biggest question, the biggest issue was where? Where do we put a 13th elementary school? Location, 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 and there just doesn't seem to be a clear answer to that. So there obviously needs to be a community discussion and have a lot of ideas, but one possibility, and this is kind of, bringing new perspective, is the one place that has not been transformed. I mean, Gunn is getting completely transformed. Pally is getting completely transformed. A lot of the middle school, elementary schools are getting completely transformed. Cubberly is being left alone. And there's no plans for Cubberly. It's the biggest space we own that really has not a clear use. And what about the potential of making it like a mixed use? It already has a lot of college aspects to it. Adult school, bringing in elementary school, bringing in middle school students, having extra space to making sure that there's enough space for all of the students, and understanding that the future of education potentially is an intermixing of, intergenerational communication and education from your peers.
Terry Godfrey.
So Jay just alluded to the meeting we went to last night where we learned some more about the bond work and what's left in the bond fund. And I can't remember who said it, but somebody mentioned that there are bond funds left that are designated for elementary school. And one of the things that we've discussed over the years is we have, some community values around what we want from our schools, including we want neighborhood schools. We don't want kids crossing over Oregon Expressway to get to school. We want peer streaming, which means students who go to school together at middle school move on to high school together. We currently have more growth in the south than in the north. There's space in the north. The west is a pinch point, and there's more housing coming from Stanford. So I don't exactly know where it ends up. That seems like that team seems a little more, needs a little more considered thought. But we definitely have some demographic changes where in the north it's not quite so crowded as it was. In the south it's more crowded, and in the west definitely with new housing coming from Stanford there will be something that we need to do, as long as we keep with our neighborhood schools value and that we have an open discussion about where that might end up.
Catherine Crystal Foster, 13th Elementary School.
Our elementary schools right now are bigger than we'd like them to be. Our kids do not have the space that we want, and we do have community values around neighborhood schools, small class sizes. Small class sizes being something that I think all of us hold dear. There's funding for a 13th elementary school, but a real mismatch between the available spaces that we have and where the growth is. Growth is in the south and mostly in the west, even more in the west than anywhere else, and that's where we're kind of hurting for a site. We also have, and this was mentioned by others, we have a real problem in the middle schools. Our growth in our elementary schools was flat last year, and the early numbers from this year also show flat growth in elementary school. That gives us the opportunity to plan a little bit before we put in a 13th elementary school in place and make sure that it's one that we site based on a really robust community conversation about where we want to have that school, what the impacts are going to be on the neighborhood, and how it fits in with other kinds of things like choice programs.
Ken Dalbert, what was your question? 13th elementary school.
Yes, we should open a 13th elementary school. and I think that we actually really need to understand the urgency of this, because it has crept up on us through many years of delayed decisions in the school board. The average size of an elementary school in Palo Alto has gone up by over 30% in the last 20 years. Yet we have only opened one new elementary school during that time at Barron Park. Research shows that the optimum size for an elementary school is between 300 and 400 students. That's what our community values are. That's what our school board has said in the past. We are way past that point for many of our elementary schools. The benefits of a 13th elementary school aren't just about having smaller schools. They're also about having less overflows, more bikeable and walkable schools, less traffic in the city. It's just the right thing to do. And I'm happy to hear that. I think that I'm hearing some broad agreement on that point. I agree with Terry that the question of where that school ought to be is a question that we need to address, but we need to address it quickly because one of the legacies of many years of not making this decision is we actually have a lot of data about the sites that we have available and so forth. So I don't think it needs to be a long process to make that decision.
Thank you very much. That completes the five question segment for and from our panelists. At the risk of striking fear into the heart of our sponsors, I'm going to go totally off script.
We can't wait.
And I'd like to ask some rapid fire questions of the panelists, 15 seconds, 30 seconds at the most, that are designed to help the audience and the public get a better sense of just who you are as people. You've given very thoughtful answers to very probing questions. So here we go, and again, answer the question, please. One sentence to explain. I've got three questions in mind. We're going to do this lickety-split. First question, what book have you read that really changed your life or reshaped your view of the world? Gina Dalma, the book and a sentence.
Alain de Botton, The Art of Travel. He is a masterpiece in every single page. Read it.
Terry Godfrey?
You'll laugh, but the book I really love is Standing Under the Rainbow by Fanny Flagg. And it's one of those books that just brings me home. It's a book we read with our kids many, many times and in many different spaces. And it changed my life by reminding me how families can come together around books, no matter what book it is.
Ken Dauber.
So the book that probably changed my life is a book called Science in Action by Bruno Latour, who's probably the greatest living sociologist. And what it really does is show that the things that we now accept as fact took people to build them and construct them into durable things that we believe in. It's a great book.
Catherine Crystal Foster.
100 Years of Solitude. It was recommended to me by a teacher, and it was something that changed my whole view. Magical realism was new at the time that it was written. It kind of bent completely my view of what fiction could be, and it was so wonderful to have a teacher recommend it to me and have it be something that we could talk about together.
Jay Cabrera?
The book I come back to over and over again is called The Universe, and it's like a big, thick book with tons of pictures, got a lot of pictures. It has a lot of information as well, and just a little background. My dad is a physicist, so that kind of puts a little perspective.
Next question, and again, 15 seconds if you can, 30 seconds max. What makes you laugh? Catherine Crystal Foster.
He does. my 13-year-old son never stops me from laughing.
Just about everything makes me laugh, Joe, actually. I find a lot of things comical.
What makes you laugh?
Myself. I think that the ability of laugh about the ridiculousness of our own being is a joy.
Hours of Netflix comedy shows and the Horseman is the recent one.
The golf course. You should see me golf. It's awful. I laugh at the other people. I laugh at myself. The only person I don't laugh at is my husband. I'd be divorced.
Third and final quick answer. Who do you admire and why? Terry Godfrey.
Admire my mom. Look, you make me cry because I love my mom a lot. She raised great kids and worked very hard every day and said, when there's a fight, you stand up and fight back. You don't walk away.
Gina Dalma, who do you admire and why?
My father. He said, you focus on education because it's not only because of the impact that you can have in your own well-being, it's the impact that you can have on the rest of the world.
Catherine Crystal Foster, who do you admire and why?
Gonna be boring. It's my dad. My dad is the highest integrity person that I know. I've never heard him say, I've never heard him raise his voice or say a dishonest word.
Jay Cabrera, who do you admire and why?
I think it would be like Nelson Mandela, you know, and just his courage and prowess and, you know, giving for people who are disadvantaged.
Ken Dauber, who do you admire and why?
I admire my wife. I mean, she's been a real voice for social justice, and she's been standing up for victims of sexual assault at Stanford against an administration that hasn't been doing as much as it could, and I think she's shown real courage in that.
All right. How about a round of applause for these folks who were willing to be a little bit revealing? And if I'm not here 2 years from now, you'll know why. Now we go to questions from the audience. Questions from the audience. 1 minute, random order again. Teacher tenure, do you support it, or are you for revising and changing it? Teacher tenure. Ken Dauber.
I do support teacher tenure. I think that teachers, you know, face a very complicated set of stakeholders, and they need job protections in order to be able to speak freely and exercise the independence that we really want them to exercise in the classroom. I think that teacher tenure is probably too short in California. I think that I certainly have heard from a lot of teachers that the year and a half to permanent status doesn't give enough time for teachers to be evaluated, but more importantly for teachers to get the kind of mentoring and support that they need to really become good teachers. The idea that a teacher after 18 months is sort of ready to graduate into the classroom as a full-fledged teacher, I just don't think that's fair to teachers and to new teachers. So that's a change that I would support.
Jay Cabrera, teacher tenure?
Yeah, definitely support teacher tenure. I agree the 3-year mark seems a little more reasonable than the 18-month mark. It should be extremely difficult for the administration to fire a teacher, but it should be very, you know, fluid for the community and the parents and the students and, you know, and colleagues to want to get rid of a teacher. You know, if that happens, it shouldn't be that hard to do it. And, you know, overall, it's just essential to have, you know, 720 evaluation where both students and parents and, you know, other colleague teachers are all evaluating each other.
Catherine Crystal Foster, tenure.
I believe that we need to value our teachers, and I believe the teachers should have very strong due process rights because, you know, we're very fortunate here. We live in a little bit of a bubble where we don't necessarily have teachers who are being fired because of their political views or their hairdos or their choice of life partner. However, I do think that you could not find a profession where you where in anywhere in the world where anyone could feel that after a year and a half you would know whether someone has mastered their craft or not. With a 2-year tenure system, we need to make decisions after a year and a half. So absolutely, I strongly believe that if a tenure system is in place, it needs to be longer for the sake of the teachers as well as for the sake of the students. You can't find who the best teachers are even at that time, much less find the ones who need more support. The real question is what kind of supports can we provide to our teachers, and how can we ensure that the tenure process that we have in our district is one that is really thorough and transparent and allows all of the relevant parties to have the necessary input into who we're going to be teaching our children.
Thank you very much. Gina Dalma.
I think there's going to be a lot of consistency in the answers that we're giving today. I do support teacher tenure. I would also extend the time to receive the tenure. I believe strongly in teacher assessment in terms of student growth, but I would make sure that I'm coupling the teacher assessment with very, very structured support systems to assure that the teacher is able to achieve their goals, and their goals are student success and providing that instructional framework for their kids.
Terry Godfrey.
Okay, this is hard to go last. Yes, I support teacher tenure. I'm going to bore my comrades here with the same story I told the other day about my two best friends from high school who both teach in Riverside, California, one of whom used to have a ponytail and had hair at the time, actually. And he encountered parents who wanted him fired because they didn't like his ponytail and they didn't like his earring. And he managed to survive that because he had tenure and there was no due process. and under which he was going to be fired. And then within 10 years, he was Teacher of the Year, Riverside Unified High School District. That's the kind of story that happens, and we need to protect those stories. But we also need to understand that the tenure process is a process which would benefit from a clear, repeatable, transparent process so that teachers know exactly how they're being evaluated, who is evaluating them, and that if there needs to be course corrections, that those course corrections aren't punitive, but are there to develop the teacher more, because we don't want to hire people and get rid of them. We want to hire people and develop them.
Thank you very much. 30 seconds for this next question. When will the school district need another bond issue to expand the schools yet again to accommodate housing growth? Catherine Crystal Foster?
We don't need one yet. We have some money that is currently in abeyance right now. It's unclear also how much housing growth we're actually going to have. I think that we'll probably be able to answer that question a little bit more after the city council election. But right now we have plenty of bond authority that we have under our current bond and money available.
All right, Jacob Rare.
Yeah, they said that of the $750 million, there's still $255 million that hasn't been spent, and of that, there's $60 million left. So it could be used up pretty quickly in the context of, if you build a new elementary school, it'll more or less be gone. Really, the question is, do we want to invest in more upgrades? Not just necessarily building a whole brand new school, but really upgrading technologically and the inside of the classroom and in building resources for students. So that's a possibility.
Terry Godfrey.
Our original construction long-range plan was $700 million that Jay just mentioned. And we went out for the bond for a little more than half of it. And as you know, we're spending our way through that. And you can see the results all over town. We do have some left that we have designated for elementary schools. It's not clear to me when we have to go back out for more. We're still digesting the new buildings and bringing them online. So I don't exactly know when that happens. It's part of our longer range capital planning process. It feels like Bob Golton's got that pretty well in hand.
Ken Dauber.
So one of the things that the answer to the question is I don't know when we'll need to go out, and I think it depends in part on what does happen with housing in the city. I think that depends in part on the city council elections. It also depends on things like how intensively our housing stock is used. One of the things that seems to be distinctive about Palo Alto is that if a housing unit becomes available, it's much more likely than in other cities for that to be filled with parents with kids because of the high value that people place on our schools. So it isn't just new housing stock that brings children into the city, it's existing housing stock.
Thank you. Gina Dalma.
So our expected growth, we're expected to have 16,000 kids in our school district by 2025. I think that we should be thinking and planning ahead what exactly are we going to need in 5, 10 years and plan the bond accordingly. I don't think it's an immediate thing. I would basically take two steps back and really plan ahead. When do we need the 13th elementary now? When do we need the fourth middle school? When do we need, how are we growing thoughtfully in terms of our expected growth?
All right, another 30-second question. How might the arrival of the new superintendent influence your initial priorities as a new board member? Impact of the new superintendent, how, if at all, would it influence your initial priorities as a new board member? Let's start with Terry Godfrey.
Well, if you haven't met our new superintendent yet, you should go meet him. He is an enthusiastic, smart, experienced guy who's ready to hit the ground running, and he has. So we really have this great moment where we have somebody who's lots of experience at all different levels of education and has in his own family experience with special education and with educating socioeconomically disadvantaged kids, and really a skill set that it would behoove us to take advantage of. Not only that, but it comes from, starting a new school with innovation. Use the red thing already.
30 seconds.
Dang.
Sorry about that. 30 seconds, Gina Dalma.
So I also share your excitement. I think that he has set a clear vision for our school district, and I think that at this point, the board should be to make sure that we are assuring that all the policies are aligned to achieving that goal. There's three things that I would work very hard at. I would assure that we are building the systems in place to continuously learn and help us achieve the vision. I would make sure that we're bringing the community along shared towards that shared goal. And again, as Ken said previously, I would make sure that we're connecting with our community inside and outside our geographic boundaries.
All right, Ken Dauber.
Well, I think our new superintendent is really terrific, and you know, he's bringing a lot, a real focus on results, on consistency, on the focus on teaching and learning. I think the most important thing that the board can do is get behind him and push, basically, because I think we have the opportunity to create a virtuous cycle where his success in getting things done and demonstrating the results to the community is going to produce more support for the kind of positive, proactive changes that that I think he's interested in, I'm interested in, I think the community is interested in.
Jay Cabrera.
Yeah, I met him yesterday. He's amazing, and he it brings an outside perspective. Obviously, he hasn't gone to school in the Palo Alto Unified School District, but I feel that I would really relate with him that, you know, although I have experience running an educational institution, it'll be new running the Palo Alto Unified School District. One of the things he brought up over and over again was a community of culture, and that he wants to bring and open up the whole community to get involved in the processes that are going on. And he specifically talked about that, parents and teachers and other community members come to him and specifically say that they have expertise in a certain area. So let's empower parents to get involved in running things.
Catherine Crystal Foster.
I'm going to join in and echo so much of what I heard here today. I think that there's a tremendous amount of energy and goodwill that goes along with the start of our new superintendent. I, frankly, was delighted to hear his interest in innovation, in his interest in collaboration, the fact that he really believes deeply in accountability and transparency and communication. These are the things that are going to drive our community forward. And he's very action-oriented, which I think is terrific. This is someone who he's out there every day. Again, I echo what Terry said. He's go have a second cup of coffee with him, which is what he's doing all over town, and hear what he has to say.
I want to squeeze in a few extra questions, and that's why we're using the 30-second rule. So here's one for 30 seconds. What's your vision for partnership with the city in developing a long-term plan for phased development of Cubberly to meet both community center and future school needs at the site? A nice crisp answer in 30 seconds. Gina Dalma.
So I think that it would be a very tight partnership. I think that we've got a huge asset in Cubberly. We need to make sure that there's a community vision for that space. The magic about this space is co-locating is a really cool idea. Having a high school there with community services that serve the whole community is a great innovative idea. So I would have develop a clear vision in partnership with the city.
Ken Dauber.
I think that it's critical that we partner with the city to make the best use of Cubberly as a community asset. I think that both the city and the school district are probably going to have to give a little bit in the short term and probably in the medium and long term. I think compromise is going to be important. I think that on the school district side, I think it's important that we come forward, that we be willing to do joint planning with the city, and that we be willing to make the kinds of commitments that enable the city and the school district to go to their respective citizens and ask for the support that they need in order to turn Cubberly into the kind of asset that we really want.
Catherine Crystal Foster.
We need to have a very positive, collaborative, and again, action-oriented relationship with the city. I think that we've let this incredible jewel in our community sit and deteriorate for too long. The first recommendation of the Citizens Advisory Committee on Cubberly was to have a community needs assessment, a professional community needs assessment, and that's where I would go to first. Let's turn this into something that our community needs. Definitely use the ability to co-locate different services there, and think about what we could do to really energize our student learning by having some kind of shared community space, maybe having a design lab, childcare, other things.
Terry Godfrey.
So we do have a history of being able to work with the city on some things, right? Project Safety Net is a great example when we have a very strong shared goal around youth well-being and suicide prevention where we can come together and do it. I'm not sure why Copper League went off the rails, but I think we can take a step back. We have new leadership at the district, so at least it changes one player in the equation. And I think we do have shared goals around that community asset that we feel very strongly about. And so I'm hoping that just taking that step back, changing leadership, remembering that we've done collaboration with the city many, many times, that we can do that.
And the last question before we go to closing statements. Forgive me, Jay, you were next in line and take your 30 seconds, my apologies.
I touched on it earlier, but it seems like, you know, we have 26 acres that are part of the Palo Alto School District, and then there's another X number of acres that the city owns. And that space, you know, you build beautiful state-of-the-art buildings. They would all be two-story, right? You technically could fit, you know, an extension of Juana Briones, like a, you know, elementary school there, an extension of JLS, you know, have some middle school activity there, and then some type of high school that would be more of a, you know, college preparatory school, you know, because Foothill is already involved there. And you could do a really amazing mixed interactive thing. So a lot of possibilities.
Last question, 30 seconds. Given all the wonderful ideas that you all have shared with the community, what would you do to control expenses? 30 seconds. Question is, what would you do to control expenses? Gina Dalma.
Well, thank you, sir. What would I do that in 30 seconds? So let me rephrase that question. And what I would say is I would make sure that we have a clear vision for, again, success for all kids. Make sure that we are aligning the activities to achieve the vision. And most importantly, make sure that we are aligning the budget for the activities to achieve the vision. So I'm not sure it's going to require that we control expenses. I want to just make sure they're the right expenses.
Show extreme discipline in doing only that which is contemplated under our strategic plan. And when we evaluate, we have to be willing to let go of things that we may like that are actually not working or not effective. If they don't generate the outcomes that we want, then we need to let them go. And as a community, we need to understand that, as Kevin Skelly often used to say, we can do anything, but we can't do everything.
So the district has a pretty conservative budgeting process already. So, and it's pretty rigorous. Much like what Catherine just said, as we make decisions going forward, if we want to add things, we have to decide what gets shrunk, what gets changed. If we do an evaluation and we feel like that hasn't met the need, then we have to make some tough decisions. Tough decisions are what you have to make on behalf of your community, because the community won't forever fund parcel taxes and bond measures if they think that you're not managing your finances very carefully. Luckily for me, that's something I've spent a lot of time doing for many years, so I look forward to the challenge.
Jay Cabrera.
Yeah, I feel it starts with transparency and accountability. The community needs to hold the superintendent's office and the board accountable. We have $200 million budget. We've got an additional $300 million of bond measure. And, you know, I feel that it's like $5 million per person max. How can anyone track more than $5 million? So you get, you know, we need minimum 40 people, you know, maybe even 80 people, you know, students could sign up too. Look at $5 million of the budget and let us know how it's going, you know, and really get into detail.
And that leads us to Ken Dauber.
I think here's where the principle of putting students first is really helpful. There's lots of things we can spend money on, but we need to be able to tie an expenditure to positive learning outcomes for kids. And if we can't make that connection, then we shouldn't be spending the money on it. So there are things like legal fees that I talked about before that I don't think can be tied directly to that. We had a controversial decision to hire a PR officer a year and a half ago. I think that's a decision that it may not be possible to tie to positive learning outcomes for kids. I think if we keep our eye focused on the organization's mission and reject expenses that aren't consistent with it, then that's the best way to limit unnecessary spending.
Thank you all. Candidates, it's time now to give each of you 2 minutes to tell the public, the community, the audience, what you would like to tell them. I would just say, I'm sure many of the folks who are here tonight and who will be watching in the days and weeks ahead are thinking to themselves, my goodness, what a qualified group of folks we have running for the Palo Alto School Board, but they only get to choose two. So you might think in your final closing statement about sharing with us why one of those two people should be you. In random order, Terry Godfrey, 2 minutes.
Okay, he's right, you have two votes. So let me just say a couple of things. I've been in Palo Alto for 15 years now. Most of those 15 years, I spent a lot of time in our school district on top of my full-time job. I now work part-time. My commitment to our youth is deep and long-standing. As I mentioned earlier, I've used the skills as a senior manager to run organizations that benefit our youth directly, and I use my day-to-day skills with kids to build developmental assets. So I have many years in and around our students, showing our commitment to our students. And you might find that most people who run for school board feel pretty strongly about students. So that maybe isn't a point of differentiation. But the experience that I have with them and the commitment is. I think when you look at the school board, you want to look at the makeup of the school board and what's there and what skills come with those people so that you have a good complementary skill set. So for me, I think I mentioned earlier, my professional career was around management and finance. I worked at Intel for more than a decade. I was the director of finance and strategic planning at the Graduate School of Business at Stanford. And I currently work as a finance director for a national immigration coalition. So lots of years in those kinds of roles, years with HR and organizational design as well. So that skill set's a little different than what we have on the board now and what will still be sitting there. So I would urge you to think about how that might play as we think about all these new things to build and all these new things to do and how we sort of make that all work. Thank you. Additionally, I think my ability to work across groups and to collaborate is well-founded and well-proven. I was a founding member of Project Safety Net, and that I came to the table as PTA Council President, and then I stayed. Even when I was no longer in that role, I was very committed to that work. And I found times when, for example, when our city manager called at the last minute and said, we need to call the Dr. Phil show and have them not do a story about suicides in our community because that won't help. That call came because I'm ready to step up, do what's right for kids, and collaborate across those lines. And those are the kinds of skills I bring.
Thanks very much. Jacob Rara.
You know, when you think of who to elect for a school board, you know, it kind of pops in your mind a parent, right? I would be, in essence, an alternative candidate, and so why would you vote for someone who's not necessarily a parent, has someone in the school? And the answer is that, you know, the goal is to have a holistic school board that can be, you know, really productive. And it might not necessarily be the best thing to have everybody on the school board have the exact same perspective or similar perspectives. And what about the potential ability to have someone add to that experience of the school board who has a different perspective, you know, and bring in new ideas and new energy from a, you know, either younger and or an alumni. So my background, you know, I grew up on Stanford campus and in Palo Alto. I went to Nixon, I graduated from JLS, and I graduated from Gunn High School in 1998. From there, I went to UC Santa Cruz. I studied environmental biology and environmental studies, right? Primarily focusing on sustainability. And in my senior year, I ran for student government. I got involved in a lot of student government. I got elected to the number two position in student government. I was the internal vice chair. It's the number two position. And so with that, I was also the chair of the student committee on committees, which oversaw all the student appointments, the hundreds of administrative committees across the entire campus. So I got a really bird's eye view of how a university and an educational institution is run. And so, you know, from that experience, I feel like I have a perspective that, you know, obviously if there was one position, you wouldn't necessarily want to vote me in, but having two bring an additional perspective could be really beneficial to the board. And of course, it's up to the community to decide what they and who they want to vote for. The only other thing I want to say is that I'm a huge proponent of interactivity, building online systems of governance, direct voting on every decision so that the community can have direct input and create community systems. And obviously, I'm also supportive of coding being an educational system so that students are learning how to work with computers early on.
Thank you very much. Ken Dava.
So we have great schools in Palo Alto. We should be grateful for them. And I have devoted an enormous amount, I think, of time and energy to making our schools work even better for our kids. And I think that record of commitment and work on behalf of specific, concrete good things, like a homework policy, like better guidance counseling, like a high school graduation requirement that makes sure that all of our kids are college ready. I think that's a record that you should like and that you should vote for. I think it shows commitment. But I also think that you should vote for me and you should choose among candidates because you like the things that we're committed to actually getting done. So I want to tell you again what those things are. I'm committed after the election to working on finally implementing our homework policy, to finally opening a 13th elementary school in Palo Alto, to teaching foreign languages to all of our elementary school students, to putting the district on the right course on civil rights, on solving simple but important problems for our kids like work pileups in middle and high school by coordinating teacher schedules, like working on improving consistency among teachers teaching the same course. Those are the specific, and on working with the city to resolve Carbali, those are the kinds of specific commitments that I am making to you because I think those are the kinds of commitments that you should be voting for. I'm committed to working with my fellow board members to create a more participative, transparent, and inclusive school board. And I'm committed to continuing to support our great teachers and to work with my fellow board members on policies that identify and support our innovative teachers and lift up their innovations across the district. And I'm committed to supporting our new superintendent as he works to increase consistency, to lift up achievement for all students, and to engage our whole community in a positive program for our students. So I ask for your vote in November, and I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you. Gina Dalma?
So first, I want to thank all of you for participating in this democratic process. It truly is an honor for me to participate in it. As all of you, I believe in the potential for each and every one of our kids to change the world. And I believe we have all the foundational elements in our school districts to make that happen. I think we have truly the best students, the best teachers, amazing administrators and an amazing new superintendent, and the most creative community in the world. And I want to make sure that all those assets are truly securing Palo Alto in the forefront of education and innovation. And I would specifically work in three things. First, I would make sure that we are creating this learning institution that you often heard me talk about, embracing innovation and assuring that we are looking at what works and scaling it consistently, making sure that we're collaborating with our entire community towards a very clear vision of student success for all. And finally, connecting with our community of innovators inside our geographic boundaries and outside of it. Ken mentioned the El Camino Road. There's a lot of roads in our community that we need to cross to be looking at this innovation, and this innovation is global now. I was born and raised in Mexico, and I bring a diverse perspective to the way I look at things. I was trained as an economist, and for the past 10 years, I've been focused on education and education innovation. First, I was the director of innovation for the Silicon Valley Education Foundation, and now I have the great privilege of managing the Silicon Valley Community Foundation's investment in education, which allows me, again, to be looking continuously at what is happening and what we can do for our students and bring that knowledge to our community and also take the amazing innovation that's happening in the community to the rest of the region, the state, and the nation.
And finally, Catherine Crystal Foster.
Thank you, Supervisor Smitty. And I want to also thank The Weekly, thank my colleagues, and thank all of you for coming out and hanging in there with us this late. It's this kind of engagement and participation that makes our community great and makes our schools great as well. I have decided to run for school board because I am deeply passionate about educational excellence and about maximizing the potential of every single one of the students in our school district.
For 20 years, I have worked for kids. This is my life's work. When we sit and we talk about the achievement gap, for me, what I'm thinking about is I'm thinking about Raul and Priscilla, two Peninsula College Fund scholars who I sat with and struggled with and was able to see graduate from college, even though they were the first in their families and they were overcoming all kinds of obstacles. Where the rubber hits the road for the achievement gap, I know what those experiences feel like. And when we talk about preparing our kids for the careers that don't yet exist, I draw on the conversations that I had with colleagues at the Gates Foundation as we were sitting down with leading thinkers talking about what's next in education. When I think about all of the struggles that we have with our budget, I turn to the work that I did with the Children's Defense Fund, analyzing the budget and the impact on kids in California. Evaluation is something, again, that I've done over many, many years for many different organizations, digging deep to figure out how can we measure what's hard to measure? How can we ensure that education programs best serve our kids? This is the kind of work that I do because I've dedicated my life to service for kids, and it's this kind of knowledge and experience and dedication that I would bring to the board as a school board member. I believe that we're at a unique moment right now, and I do hope that all of you will consider bringing me in to the school board at this time so we can maximize this moment for the benefit of all of our students. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to Ken Dauber. Thank you to Terry Godfrey. Thank you to Jay Cabrera. Thank you to Catherine Crystal Foster. Thank you to Gina Dalma. And thank all of you for being here tonight. That is it. That's a wrap. Good luck to all the candidates. Thank you so much for running.